Yeah, please pardon me for the just shuffling. Actually, I had to start the recording thing, and since it was my turn, I had to do it with little bit of hassle. Yeah, okay. So I have introduced the topic of my talk. It's going to be about slurries encountered in 2G bioethanol production. So we start with the powder. And we mix it with water. Water is a universal solvent. Everyone knows. Of course, one can work with supercritical fluids and so on. But best thing to work with is water and some soluble alkali or acid. So once we mix this, there are two ways. One is if small amount of water is to be mixed, we take this in a beaker or a bucket and then pour the water into it and mix it with a stirrer. Second is if you want to make high dilution, large water and small amount of powder, then we have to take this in a big bucket and pour the powder into this one. So the operations depend on how much dilution factor we need it. So in general, after these two are mixed, okay, it becomes again a moist powder. This is where Dr. Srinivas was mentioning that we'll have lumps and the agglomerates of solid particle once there is water content. So normally, what we have found is that if you put a lot of water, it's not a economical thing. So we put around a dilution factor of 3. So if you take 1 kg dry powder, maybe we put around 3 kg of water, 3 liters of water equivalently, because density is around 1,000 kg per meter cube or 1 kg per liter. So it can be interchangeably used, either kgs or liters of water. So once we have this moist solid, we do the pre-treatment. Here it's a little hazy, but I wanted to show this because this has the actual representation of the extrusion process that we have it in the ASMPL's pilot plant. The mixed moist solids are subjected to a extrusion, where there is a screw extruder inside a barrel. The barrel is heated here. So we gradually put at different optimum temperatures so that as it enters this, the gap between the central rod and the barrel, the gap gradually decreases. Here it is high and here it is less. So it gets sheared, compressed, and then squeezed out. So in that process, also temperature is also heat is supplied. So when both thermochemical process occurs along with the required amount of alkali, we go for NaOH, there is certain percentage that has to be added. If you go to H2SO4, certain percentage to be added. Let us say we stick to alkali, NaOH, then this type of pulp is generated by the end of this outlet. Okay, we start with this color. When we do this operation, gradually the color changes to the material looks like a gelatinous pulp with brownish pinkish color. Okay? A combination of brown and pink. Now, why does it happen like that? That people have explained in the earlier talks, in the yesterday's talk and in the morning talk also, that because the lignin gets liberated. When the lignin gets liberated, that leads to when we wash it with water, we get the wash liquor, and the remaining thing is pre-treated powder. So this is containing large amount of cellulose. Maybe the hemicellulose is gone, lignin is gone, so only the ash is there. So that fiber, cellulose, we can say up to 90% it will be cellulose. But starting material, it is the usual percentage, 35% cellulose, 30% hemicellulose, then 20 to 25% lignin and ash. So once we have this cellulosic matter, it's again like a fluffy powder. Now we have to take it to the next step. So in the next step, we have two processes, saccharification and fermentation. These two, again, I am representing the two options. Although it has been discussed, I want to present that if we do it in a batch reactor, we have to have a tank. So this slurry has to be mixed. The whatever I have shown in the end of the previous slide, this is the pre-treated powder. Again, this has to be mixed with water. Why do we dilute it? Because it's an enzymatic process. The enzymes that we add has to reach the cellulosic molecules. So for that to happen in a solid state, it cannot happen. There are products like, for example, tea powder. They do solid state fermentation because there it has inherent catalyst which can develop those form the theophyllenes from polyphenols. So in tea industry, they do solid state fermentation. But here, if we try to do solid state fermentation, it may take very, very long time. And we may have to sprinkle a lot of enzymatic liquid. So instead of that, if we can add water to that, make it dilute, then it becomes amenable for mixing. So in a, if you have an impeller like this and it starts rotating, then whatever the enzymes we add from the top have to be mixed thoroughly, uniformly to reach every corner of the reactor containing the cellulosic material. So that is where the behavior of the fluid flow is important. So how viscous is it? What should be the horsepower of this motor that has to be fixed for the stirrer? So right now we have like 1 HP motors. So it depends again for a 60 liter tank. If it is a larger tank, where do we place this impeller? So these are the, again, the disadvantages that were discussed in the morning by Dr. Amir. That if you have a large reactor, even the dosing is ensured, but then the dosed enzyme should reach each corner. So those are the difficulties there. Now, coming to, let us say, we go with the proposition of Dr. Amir in the morning, that there is a process where we can have a tubular reactor, small tank, but large volume, 90% of the volume in the tube form. Here, we need to make it pass through this, like one pass, like let us say the identified time is 18 hours of saccharification with a required suggested dose of enzymes. So with that suggested dose of enzymes, you want to do a one pass. That means we just add it here and continuously pass it through this so that the residence time is 18 hours. How do we maintain that? That is basically the volume of the reactor should be such that volume by flow rate should be equal to the residence time, the reaction time, 18 hours. So one can go ahead, calculate it. It will come out as some several hundreds of meters or sometimes close to a kilometer like that. So tubular reactor again needs, now how do we pass the slurry through this? Let us say this has good impellers. It mixes the powder, cellulosic powder, biomass and the water and the enzymes very thoroughly. And then so here an equipment is needed, that is the pump for supplying from here. So here one needs to be very calculative. What should be the distance between the bottom of the spoon of the tank to the pump? If it is long, again, conveying becomes difficult. If it is short, there may be problems of, you know, minimum space is required for keeping a wall in case we want to maintain this tank for maintenance purpose. So there are certain aspects we need to study about how the slurries move around when there is a impeller rotating, or when it is supplied through a pump, how does it flow? Does it be like a laminar flow or turbulent flow? But students would recognize that laminar flow is if the Reynolds number is below 2100. Turbulent flow is if it is beyond 2100. Now, all the calculations of the reaction time is based on assuming that it is a flat velocity profile, but in reality it is not. There will be a residence time distribution. If you introduce some portion of raw material here, it will come out like a hill, like a peak and then down. So not everything will come out at the same time as it is introduced, okay? In the sense with a gap of residence time, but it will be a distribution. So that is called residence time distribution. So that is a standard principle of chemical engineering one can apply in studying these type of things. Okay, now what is the thing that is happening in the particular mixture that we are talking about? So these I borrowed from Mr. Navin Giri. Yeah, so we have, let us say during the pretreatment, we add alkali solution, that is water, and mix it with the corn powder, corn cob powder. Now, some portion of the particles keep floating, some portion sediment at the bottom, and some remain at the middle. So this is where the brown liquid is there, the lignin content. So density above that of water is sedimenting because it is because of the gravitational force. And the floating particles is because of buoyancy force. So we have to manage both the types of particles when we deal with reactors, either batch or in the pumps, it is even more difficult. So what we do is that this is subjected to extrusion. So when we do extrusion, this particulate matter gets is sheared and becomes like a gelatinous material that I have described in the beginning slides. So that's where we felt that, of course, steam explosion also can be done. But we found that when we do extrusion process, the consistency or the gelatinousness of the pretreated material is much better. It's uniform. So it becomes like a sludge and washing is easy. So if you leave it in flask like this, and I want to study the characteristics of this pretreatment, it won't be uniform, right? We need a thorough mixing. We need thorough mixing. And yesterday, Dr. Saikat Chakrabarty has said that we should mix it for some time, leave it for some time, again mix it. So schemes like that have to be come up. Now we have to come up with such schemes in order to cause a certain conversion of this lignin separation. Okay, so now once we have this kind of fluids, we have to see what happens if they are put in a fluid. So here I'm explaining about the sedimenting particles. If you have a uniform slurry, mix it and leave it, it will sediment. And when it comes to pipe, sorry for this haziness, like it's taken from a source. There is homogeneous flow at high Reynolds number. The particles are uniformly distributed. There is heterogeneous flow, that means there are locations of agglomerations, and at the top portion there is little bit of uniform distribution. This is again because of gravity effect. Okay, so if you do it in some other type of reactor where there is a centrifuge, and there we may not have this gravity effect. But next stage is even more further happening is saltation flow, where there will be waves kind of thing generated. And if you increase the solid concentration in the fluid, it becomes like a stationary bed at the bottom. It won't be moving. At the most, it may be sliding, but the top layer of the fluid will be moving. So these are detrimental, but the first one is what we have to ensure. So for that, the resort is to go for high Reynolds number flow. Okay, high Reynolds number flow makes it a turbulent flow. Turbulent flow has nearly a flat velocity profile, and since it is particulate laden, it can give even slightly slip velocity so that the particles at the wall won't stick to the wall. Okay. Yeah. Now, after the step of saccharification, we need to filter the medium. Now, I have shown you that when the pretreatment is done, there is lighter particles moving up, heavier particles moving down, particle segregation. Now, as the conversion of cellulose to glucose takes place, the content of the solid decreases, the particle size decreases, and gradually the viscosity of the liquid phase increases. So it becomes a sludge. So we have two methods to separate the sludge again into spent solids and liquid. One is the filter press, which Dr. Amir has shown in the morning. So we supply the slurry into layers of plates with perforated filter cloth. So only the liquid is allowed, the filtrate is allowed through one direction. At the end of it, the plates are separated and the orange colored thing is the cake. So the cake can be separated and may be used as in the agricultural field or in cardboard industry and so on. Yeah. Now the filtrate has the next step, that is fermentation. Now, okay. So alternative to batch filtration is, suppose if you want to do continuous, you want to process large amount of biomass in a short time, then there is a decanter centrifuge. It is a very effective equipment. Only thing is, once in a while it needs maintenance, it rotates at high speed, and because of centrifugal force, the solids move to one side and liquid comes to other side. It's like almost like a magic machine. Okay. So once it is installed, a continuous process can be carried out. So the scheme that was presented by one of the ASN's research scholar, Dr. Amin, that we can have a continuous reactor. So this is the logical instrument that can be, equipment that can be used subsequent to the saccharification process. That is, once glucose is obtained, this can be used. We get the glucose solution here, the filtrate, either here or here. So batch is suitable for pilot plant if you are doing with 100 liter reactor or so. For example, in our lab, we are able to handle up to 80 to 100 liters at a time. Okay, it depends on the number of plates. If you increase the number of plates, it can handle more. Okay, so now let us look at what is that differentiates this type of fluids. There is something called shear stress and shear rate. Viscosity is the shear stress to the shear rate ratio, and there are various types of rheometers for that. For example, if you take a beaker, say a solid metallic beaker, and inside that we keep a spindle and fill the gap with the fluid that we are studying and rotate the top inside cylinder, it takes higher effort if the viscosity is higher. So that is the property of a fluid in terms of viscosity that I'm describing. So higher torque is required to rotate high viscous fluid, and less torque is required for less viscous fluid. Now, if there is a sludge, then it can be, if it is a normal water, we'll get a yellow curve, something like a linear curve, zero shear rate, zero shear stress. Okay. And other type of fluids, like what we are encountering in 2G bioethanol process, is the sludge. The sludge can be shear thickening. That means as you rotate higher and higher, water separates, and then the solids become to come together and the cake resists the flow. And this Bingham plastic is example is toothpaste. So that kind of thing is for the cake material. So we are not worried much about that. Maximum we are worried about shear thickening. Shear thickening is we design a pump for certain, assuming that, let us say, we get a property here, shear stress divided by shear rate. With that, we design a pump. But then in the operation, maybe it may be running at higher shear rate. Then there, viscosity is higher. So the flow rate will decrease because the same power cannot supply higher viscous fluid at the same flow rate. So, and in the rheometers are also of various types, concentric cylinders, cone and plate rheometer, parallel plates. Each one is used for certain range of viscosities and the types of solids. For example, sludge, it comes under soft solid. When we reduce the water content, it can be tested under parallel plate. It consists of two plates where the top plate is kept at a gap and allowed to rotate. Then that effort taken to rotate determines the intensity of the magnitude of the viscosity of the fluid. And the viscosity is not one value. It can depend on the shear rate. So that's it doesn't depend on shear rate for Newtonian fluids. So those are called Newtonian fluids. Again, Newton appears everywhere. Yes, done work in every field. Yeah. So once we have characterized the fluid, what type of pump do we select? Dr. Amir has introduced screw pump. In this is the suction and this is the delivery. So in this portion, there is a stator and rotor. Stator is usually made of slightly flexible material, like polymeric material, but the rotor is made of steel. Again, corrosion is a factor, so one should take care that there should not be any mild steel parts in our machine. Anything SS304, SS316, they are good. Okay, so what about why we are using screw pump or the progressive cavity pump? This is because Dr. Amir has said that with 1 inch inlet and 1 inch outlet, it was able to work, but sometimes there was a problem. So we changed it to 40 mm ID inlet and 40 mm outlet, and the pipes are also 40 mm ID pipes, and there was no problem. And in fact, the flow rate was 2000 liters per hour. So that is a very high flow rate, and the recycle time is also short. And then the uniformity of enzyme concentration is achieved. So, but when we go for very high flow rate in a centrifugal pump, this is different from this kind of thing. Here there is an impeller that keeps rotating. Suction is on this side and delivery is upwards. So this can be used when we go for large scale. See, at pilot scale, 40 mm diameter, it may be difficult, but in large scale, when we go to industrial plant scale, there it might be 200 mm diameter. In that stage, our particle size is 2 mm or 3 mm. So that won't hinder the or block the impeller. So at that time, we can use centrifugal pumps. And even for the fermentation also, we can use centrifugal pumps because it has only ethanol. After glucose water is fermented, we get ethanol solution. So the viscosity is anywhere between, decreases actually from 50 to 100 centipoise down. Yeah. So these are the things I wanted to present. And little more about screw pumps is that they supply the flow rate, supposed to supply constant flow rate, but because of this is the data taken from a paper, if you increase the pressure head, that means say the spiral serpentine pipes go one over the other and then they are 1 meter height. Sometimes they may be 2 meter height. In that case, as the differential pressure increases, the flow rate decreases. Suppose we buy it at this one, 4 MPa, that is 40 atmospheres. The flow rate is about in meter cube per day, this much, 40. But if you operate at a high pressure, suppose we change the architecture of the of our tubular reactor, then it will slightly decrease if the length of the pipe is higher, but not majorly. One can take this into consideration while designing the pump capacity. Usually, 1.5 HP like that is sufficient for a pilot scale, like the 100 liter or 600 liter reactor that Dr. Amir was discussing in the morning. Now, scale up is one of the things. Inner diameter of the tube has to be selected according to the flow rate so that the Reynolds number will be in turbulent regime. That is one thing. And one has to decide what should be the length of the straight tube so that it is easy for maintenance also. Like we cannot take a 100 meter long tube, even if it comes in the design. We have to save the space in a layout of the industry. And turn radius is important. Depending on the ID of the tube, the turn radius can also be accordingly calculated so that the accumulation or refitting of these joints is amenable for maintenance. Okay, then total pressure drop also has to be calculated before designing the pump, and pump selection can be done. Like if it is a large diameter pipe, yeah, centrifugal pump can be used. If it is a pilot plant scale like 40 mm diameter or lower, one can use the screw pumps. Okay, so to conclude, we have looked at the water requirement. That's what is important. For pre-treatment, the dilution factor to be 3 to 3.5. Because the instrument used is the extrusion process. And then for washing, nearly 10 times the pulp volume is used. So accordingly, one has to deal with the impellers for a washing, automated washing machine. Suppose if someone wants to design a tank with a perforated plate and all those things, one can design based on 10 times, the viscosity will be less, around 100 centipoise or so. But this one will be like paste. Now, when we come to saccharification, the dilution factor starts with 5 and increases to 7, or it kind of, it's a variable between 5 to 7. Anything below 5, again, flowability is a problem, right? Because it is a sludge. And anything above 7, it leads to higher dilution in the fermentation, and that will reduce, increase the cost of distillation. So in fermentation also, the dilution factor, suppose if you don't filter it, it should be better below the factor of 10 for, again, economic benefit in the distillation process. So with that, I would like to conclude. I hope I have given an idea of what kind of fluids we encountered, and then the particulate fluids properties, and some motivation of why there can be research in this area. Thank you all. Yeah, if there are questions, I can definitely answer.